Shalom, and welcome to Via Havta Yisrael, a Hebrew phrase which means, you shall love Israel. We hope you'll stay with us for the next 30 minutes as our teacher, Dr. Baruch, shares his expository teaching from the Bible. Dr. Baruch is the senior lecturer at the Zera Avraham Institute based in Israel. Although all courses are taught in Hebrew at the Institute, Dr. Baruch is pleased to share this weekly address in English. To find out more about our work in Israel, please visit us on the web at loveisrael.org. That's one word, loveisrael.org. Now, here's Baruch with today's lesson.
One of the most important concepts throughout the scripture, it begins in the book of Genesis, it goes into the prophets, throughout the book of Psalms, into the new covenant, and especially in the book of Revelation, we see the concept of redemption. If we're going to understand our faith, if we're going to perceive correctly the work of Messiah Yeshua, if we are going to understand our hope in the kingdom of God, then we need to understand this concept of redemption. And one of the best places to look in the Bible for a proper understanding of redemption, and the answer may surprise you, is the book of Ruth. Only four chapters, but this book of Ruth is so significant. And throughout the book of Ruth, we see principles that laid the foundation for us understanding properly our faith in Messiah Yeshua. Because when the book of Ruth ends, it ends with a genealogy. And that list of people's birth, what do we find? We find it begins with a very significant individual. And it ends with King David. And why is that important? Because whenever King David is mentioned, we need to be thinking about the Messiah. So this book of Ruth goes a long way in helping us understand who the Messiah is by outlining for us some biblical principles. So with that said, take out your Bible and look with me to the book of Ruth and chapter 1. The book of Ruth and chapter 1. We begin here in verse 1 where it says, "And it came about in the days that judges were judging." Now, what do we know about this period of time known as the Judges? Well, if you look at the book of Judges, you'll find something. You will find that everyone was doing what was right in their own eyes. Now, when we pay attention to that statement, we see something. We learn that everyone was trying to do what was right, but according to their own perspective, according to their own thoughts, how they saw things, how they understood them. And when we live out our lives doing the very best we can, remember what the scripture says. They were doing what was right in their own eyes. But when we do what was right in our eyes, what does the scripture say? Well, if we keep reading in the book of Judges, we see that it says, but they were doing evil in the eyes of the Lord. Now that just goes and teaches us a very important principle, and that is this. Our ways are not God's ways. Our thoughts are not His thoughts. So when you set out to do the right thing, left to yourself, without revelation from God, without His instructions, you will do what is wrong. And what will you find yourself in? Trouble. You will find as we go about doing our very best according to our limited knowledge, we will find ourselves moving to trouble. That God will not be pleased with our behavior, and therefore there will be a consequence. And that's exactly what is revealed to us in this first verse of chapter 1. Look at it again. We read, "And it came about in the days that judges were judging," and then we see the exact same word that opens up the scripture in the Hebrew, the word vayehi, which means, "and it came about." And why is that word reported twice here? Answer is simple. In order to tie these two things together, we need to realize that the Word of God is written away in order to help us understand what God wants to communicate to us. So we see that it was the time of Judges, and it's introduced by the phrase, "and it came about." And then that same phrase is repeated to help us to understand the outcome of what happens when we do what is right in our own eyes. And what is that? Well, we read, "And it came about a famine in the land." Always in the scripture, when we see a famine being mentioned, it is to show God's displeasure, God's dissatisfaction with his people, because they were not doing what he instructed them to do. And one of the questions that we should be asking ourselves is this: am I doing what I think is best? Am I doing what I think is right? Or have I heard from God? Have I paid attention to scriptural truth and applied that scriptural truth to my life? That's the question. That is how we're going to be evaluated. Remember what the Word of God says. Messiah is coming. He is going to return. And the scripture tells us that he is going to render to each individual according to his deeds. How he evaluates our deeds. Now here we're not talking about salvation. We're talking about rewards. But a wise person is going to want rewards. Why? These rewards are going to be used to honor God, to worship our Messiah, as a testimony of what our faith really brought about in our life. So once more, verse 1. "And it came about in the days that judges were judging, that it came about a flood in the land, and a man went," and pay very close attention, "a man went," and this man was from Bethlehem, that is Bethlehem of Judea. Now, right there, we're going to see that this phrase, Bethlehem or Bethlehem, it's going to be reported in the scripture many times. And why is that? To show emphasis. And when Bethlehem is mentioned, what should come into our mind? Well, it is the birthplace of King David. That's where he's from. And also, we learn prophetically, it is connected to the son of David. And of course, I'm speaking about Messiah. So right here in verse 1, we learn something. That this book of Ruth has significance for us in a proper perception, being able to discern Messiah, what he's supposed to do. And remember how we began. We spoke of the fact that this book of Ruth is highly connected to redemption. And therefore, we should learn that Messiah is highly connected to redemption. That is, he is our Redeemer. And there's an inherent relationship between redemption and the kingdom. Without being redeemed, you can have no kingdom expectation. So this man, he went from Bethlehem of Judea, in order, it says, to live in the fields of Moab. And this is a wrong thing to do. We know biblically that God brings his people into the promised land. It's there in the land of promise that we can have an expectation for God's blessings, expectations for his provision in our life. And when we leave the land of Israel, what is the scripture telling us? That we're turning away from God's activity in our life. And instead of God blessing, providing, we're going to find ourselves encountering his judgment. That's what we should expect, and that's what we're going to see in a few minutes. So this man from Bethlehem, he departed and he went to live in the fields of Moab, him and his wife and his two sons. Look now to verse 2. The name of the man was Elimelech. Now Elimelech is two Hebrew words. Eli, which means my God, and Melech, which means king. But is that true? I mean, his name proclaimed that Jehovah God was his God, his king, the rule of his life. But in actuality, he did not live up to that name. Why? Because he was not a man who was trusting in the provision of God. And there's also another interpretation of why he left. He left, and we're going to see a reference to this later on, He was a very wealthy man. And he knew something. When the time of famine was harsh, people would be in great need. He had resources because he was a wealthy man. We'll see the scripture attest to that in a few minutes. He was wealthy and he didn't want to share. He didn't want to live a life that reflected the love of God. And we've talked so many times how there is a relationship between love and the Torah. We remember that the first commandment, that is the most significant one, is love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. And the second one, Yeshua said, is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. What do they have in common? Love. So when we embrace a Torah lifestyle, when we submit to the Word of God, we are going to be manifesting love. And that love is going to be because God has first loved us. And as we love God, we're going to demonstrate that love of God for other individuals. And unfortunately, Elimelech, he didn't have that. He didn't want to do it. He wanted to keep what he had and not share it with other people. So he left, and we find here that he went into the plains of Moab, him and his entire family. Look again at verse 2. The name of the man was Elimelech, and the name of his wife Naomi, and this means pleasant. And then finally, we find that the name of his two sons were Mahlon and Chilion. They were Ephraimites from Bethlehem of Judea. So now we have the second time in the second verse that Bethlehem or Bethlehem is mentioned. And there's another play on words, because the word Bethlehem is two Hebrew words. Bet meaning house of, and lechem bread. And it can be understood as a place of provision. So here Elimelech and his family, his wife Naomi and his two sons, they lived in the place that spoke about God's provision. But instead of trusting God, realizing, well, if there's a famine in the land, God is displeased. He's calling us to repentance. He's calling us to embrace His Word so that we can do so and be blessed. Instead of that, what do? They just leave. Now look at the end of verse 2. And they came to the fields of Moab, Vayihiyu Sham. Now, what does that mean? Vayihiyu Sham? Very simple. And they were there, and the implication is they were going to stay there indefinitely. They made this place, Moab, their new residence. And this is a problem. Because when we look at the Word of God, God has not blessed Moab. In fact, because of Moab's disobedience, because of their unwillingness to participate in God's will, in fact, they wanted, the Moabites wanted to thwart the things of God, God said strong words against this people. So now we find supposedly a man of Judea, a man that should have faith and trust in God. His name, God, or King, my God is King, but he's not living this out. And what can we expect? Well, look if you would to verse 3. When we willfully and in rebelliousness move away from the things of God, there's going to be a consequence. And that's what we see in verse 3. And Elimelech, he died, the husband of Naomi, and she remained, and it says, and her two sons. Now, notice that she remained, meaning she was left, we might say, with her two sons by herself. Look now to verse 4. And these two sons, it says, and they married, or they took for themselves wives, but it says Moabite wives. Now, this is a problem. And we're going to see that these wives that they took, they were not from the proper heritage, meaning this. They were not young women who had left the Moabite culture and embraced the God of Israel, at least not initially. So because of that, this was not the proper thing for them to do. Because marriage-wise, we need to be on the same spiritual foundation. It is wrong for a believer in Messiah Yeshua to marry someone who is not a believer in Messiah Yeshua. And this is what we find here as a principle. These Jewish men took Moabite women who came from the Moabite culture, at least initially. And we read in verse 4, the name of one was Orpah, and the name of the second was Ruth. And they dwelled there as 10 years, for approximately 10 years. Now, 10 is a number of completion. And why is that important? Why does the scripture reveal to us that they lived there continuing on for 10 years? To show that they had no desire to go back to Judea, back to the place of God's provision. In fact, what it's teaching us is that they became individuals who had left Israel with no intention of ever rejoining. So they were there for those 10 years. And what happens? Well, look now to verse 5. Also, the two of them, meaning the two sons, they died, that is, Mahlon and Chilion, and the woman remained with her two daughter-in-laws who were Moabite women. So now she, who had left there with three men in her life, her husband and her two sons. Her husband now has been deceased for 10 years. We find that her two sons are married to two Moabite women, and they've lived in that way in Moab for 10 years, and now God's judgment. These two young men are also put to death. And she remains there, this woman with the two Moabite women there, and apart from her husband because he's dead. Look now to verse 6. Now, verse 6 implies a change. She is perceiving, and we'll see this in the second part of chapter 1. She is perceiving, that is Naomi, God's displeasure for her. And she has not figured out why, but she understands that God has moved against her. Why is that? Because he doesn't like her? Because he wants to judge this family? No, because of their disobedience, because of their rebelliousness to God's instructions. And remember what the Word of God says. God is not a respecter of persons, meaning he doesn't treat one person this way and someone else does the same thing and God treats them differently. No, God is a God of justice. And whoever it is, when we rebel against God, we can expect that there's going to be consequences. Sooner or later, in this case, they delayed. 10 years God gave them to repent, but they did not. And therefore, she's now alone. Apart from her husband, he's been dead, and now her two sons, and she remains with the daughter-in-laws. Now look at verse 6. And she gets up, and her two daughter-in-laws, in order to return from the fields of Moab. For she had heard, and this is important, she had heard, and this word heard, remember what Paul teaches us. And that is, faith comes by hearing. And because she hears and responds, we can anticipate that this woman is going to regain faith. That she is going to begin to participate in the things of God. Now it's going to begin a process that takes time, but because she heard and acted, God is going to begin to move in his life to bring about, and here's the key, to bring about redemption. Look again at verse 6, the second half. For she heard in the field of Moab that God has visited his people. Now, where? Back in Judah, not where she is, because she has removed herself from the place of provision. She has left the land of Israel. And I want to talk a moment about this word, for God has visited. Now, this word, pakad in Hebrew, it is very frequent in the biblical text, especially in the prophets. So God visits. And here's the thing. Depending upon context, this can relate to a good thing or a bad thing, meaning God visits his people. And if his people are in a proper position, he works good things. If he visits and the people are in a disobedient location, then this word can mean judgment. So context tells us what God is actually doing. It just speaks here of his presence among the people, sometimes to bless, sometimes to judge, sometimes to restore, sometimes to scatter. Well, here we find that God has visited his people, and notice what the text says, end of verse 6, to give to them bread. The punishment now is over, and God is beginning restoring. The punishment has departed, and the bread has returned. Look now to verse 7. In verse 7 we read, and she goes forth from the place which she was there, and her two daughter-in-laws with her. And they come on the way, that is, they go on the way, to return to the land of Judah. Now here again, not only has Bethlehem been emphasized here, but Bethlehem Yehuda, that is Judah. And Judah is an important word, because Judah, that place, that tribe, we find that there's a relationship between the tribe of Judah and the inheritance of Judah and Messiah. The scripture tells us Messiah is coming from the lineage of Judah, and that he's going to be born in the allotment of land given to Judah. So whenever we see those phrases, Bethlehem, Bethlehem, and Yehuda or Judah, we know something. They oftentimes have messianic implications, and that's certainly going to be the case when we get to the final chapter of this study of the book of Ruth. Look again at verse 7. And she goes forth from that place, which she was there, and her two daughter-in-laws with her, and they go on the way to return to the land of Judah. Verse 8. And Naomi says to her two daughter-in-laws, go return each woman to the house of her mother. And let the Lord be with you, loving kindness. Now we have a problem. We see something that diagnoses for the reader, Naomi. Although she's returning back to the land because she's heard that God has moved, she still doesn't have that faith. She is very casual about the Word of God, His instructions, His character, what God does and what God doesn't do. Because she's saying, you know, young ladies, you return back to your mother's house and may God be gracious to you there. Well, that's not going to happen, because His place of grace is in His will. It is when we begin to submit to God's instructions, then and only then are we going to encounter God's chesed, His loving kindness, His mercy and grace. So what she's saying here is a hope absent of truth. It is a promise that's devoid. She says, let every one of you, these two women, Orpah and Ruth, let you go back to the house of your mother, and God will be with you gracious there. That's not the case. Just as you with the dead and with me. Now, she recognizes that these two young women had been faithful in the sense of they had been good daughter-in-laws. They loved her sons, and they loved her. But now she's going back to her country, and her implication is, you go back to your country, and it even gets worse. Look now to verse 9. And may the Lord give to you, and may you find rest, each woman in the house of her mother. Now, this word, menucha, is very important. I translate it as rest. And it's a word that's related to a kingdom rest. It has serious implications attached to it. And the idea that she's going to, each woman is going to find this kingdom rest, going back to Moab, to this place of idolatry, this place that's devoid of the Word of God, that's not going to happen. So what the Scripture is showing us is how far removed from scriptural truth and a biblically based hope Naomi is. If Naomi is going to find what God wants for her, she's going to have to grow spiritually. And this is true for all of us. We all need to watch our tongues very closely and not say things, especially spiritual things, that may be our desire, our hope, our want, may be what even we believe. But if our belief is not based upon scriptural reality, we're going to be disappointed. And if these young women go back to Moab and embrace once more their pagan heritage, well, they're not going to experience hope. In other words, they're not going to experience redemption. So she says that, and notice the end of verse 9. And she kissed them, and they lifted up their voice, and they wept. And they say to her, rather with you, we will return to your people. Now, probably it is Orpah that is speaking this, because Ruth, when she speaks next week, and we'll see this, she says something very different. And that has led the scholars to believe that it's Orpah who's speaking when she says, you know, we'll go back with you to your people. Now, wait a second. They have married into this family. Marriage, what are you supposed to do? The wife's supposed to leave and cleave to her husband. And we find here that this may not be the case with these women. So they've lifted up their voice, they're weeping, and they are willing to go to the land of Judah. But do they have faith? Are they young women that have the right perspective in regard to the God of Israel? Well, we're going to find that one does and one doesn't. And that one who truly embraces biblical truth, well, her life is going to be forever changed. And that's how you and I find change, when we embrace the truth of God. Well, I need to close with that. Until next week.
Well, we hope you will benefit from today's message and share it with others. Please plan to join us each week at this time and on this channel for our broadcast of loveisrael.org. Again, to find out more about us, please visit our website, loveisrael.org. There you will find articles and numerous other lectures by Baruch. These teachings are in video form. You may download them or watch them in streaming video. Until next week, may the Lord bless you in our Messiah Yeshua, that is, Jesus, as you walk with Him. Shalom from Israel.